Welcome everyone to another episode of Today's Investor. Today we have a special guest, Dan Diaz. He's a gentleman that's doing a lot of impactful things here in San Antonio. He's helping a lot of people, he's involved in real estate, and he's someone that a lot of you can learn from as well. Dan, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Sure, first of all, I wanna say I'm honored that I've been invited to the show. And I'm very excited to share a little bit of what has been shared to me in the beginning. I was born in Mexico, but I was raised here in San Antonio, a little town called China Grove. I grew up on land. My story is very similar to a lot of people that their parents maybe told them, you know, go to school, get good grades, go to college, you know, get a good job.
Story, right?
Yes, yes, exactly. Very, very typical. And I did that. You know, I went to school, I somewhat got good grades, but I followed that path for a while. But I think I always had the entrepreneurial bone in the back of me. And I can say that because even in college, most of my college mates, they were getting average jobs that were, you know, paying them perhaps minimum wage or a little bit over minimum wage. And from the very beginning, I was attracted to restaurant industry. And I know why. I knew that as a bartender or as a waiter, I had in a small way a direct impact on my income. I knew if I took care of more people, I took care of them better, I found a way for them to spend more, it would show in their tips and it would show in my income, and I liked that.
You could always improve, you could always increase the income.
Yes, I could work the same hours, you know, a shift of 5, 6, 7, 8 hours, but I had a way of directly impacting my income. And I really, really like that.
So you said that you had the entrepreneurial bone from the beginning. Where did that come from?
Well, my dad's, I think it came from both of my families. My dad's family in Mexico, they've always owned their own businesses. He actually comes from a fairly affluent family in Mexico, but as with many families in Mexico, perhaps things were not done so legally or so morally in a lot of things. It's something that, you know, it's part of my background. But my dad, I suspect, wanted to take us away from that, brought us to the US. And I think wanting to do the whole transformation,
sure.
He also said, no business.
Yeah. Fresh start.
Yes, fresh start. So let's follow the American dream. You know, you guys go to school, get a diploma, get a degree, and you know, and get a good job. But the bone was in me. All of my uncles, all of my aunts, they have their own businesses in Mexico. And I could tell that even in college when I picked a job, it wasn't a coincidence that I picked, you know, a waiter bartending job.
So you saw it in the family. You saw other individuals in your family, aunts, uncles, all getting involved to where they could impact their income, they can make an impact,
yes,
in the community, and that made an impact on you. So that's where it all started, and you were always looking to be able to do that yourself.
Yes, and I think that's where the spirit of it began, where I realized, hey, I don't have to settle for X amount of pay for X amount of hours. There are ways in which I can work the same amount of hours and directly impact the value that I bring to people and the income that I bring in. I didn't realize that was a business yet, but I knew it was there. You know, I really knew it was there. So I did almost 10 years in food and beverage, and then I moved on to sales. I worked for a mobile manufactured home company called Palm Harbor Homes. I started off in sales, went to sales manager, eventually became the general manager at one of the local stores.
So you were at a restaurant first.
Correct.
And then you went into, with Palm Harbor,
yes,
into sales. Were you looking for something like that at that time, or did you fall into it? How did that transition happen?
Well, I think it was a little bit of a coincidental situation. One of my bartenders was hired as a salesperson. Now, at the time, I was a manager at Texas Land and Cattle. I was the GM at the Riverwalk location. Great restaurant, by the way. So it was a little bit hard, and it was a little bit of a step down, but I was also at the point in my life where I realized I can't be in a restaurant all my life.
Sure.
10 years had passed. And I kind of liked the whole being in an office, being in an indoor environment, having a certain amount of stability, but with the aspect of controlling your income, which was sales.
So you were kind of starting to hit a ceiling almost.
Yes.
And so you were looking for the next level.
Yes.
How can I improve from here? What are what are the next set of challenges for me to hit the next plateau?
Yes, yes, okay. Exactly.
So tell me a little bit more about that. You started over at Palm Harbor, mm-hmm. so you were part of the sales, and where did you go from there?
I started at the New Braunfels location. I was eventually moved to the Elmendorf location. I progressed very quickly. I learned, the process very well. I moved from salesperson to sales manager to eventually general manager at the Elmendorf location. But this is where the real estate kind of inside knowledge really began, because as a manager, I was able to have access to 100% of the transactions. I knew how much money there was in real estate, and I knew how much money was being sent up to corporate, and I knew how little money we were keeping. Now, don't get me wrong, I was making a good salary.
Sure, sure.
But I was able to see the numbers.
You saw from beginning to end on each transaction.
Yes.
What was coming in, what was going out, and that was really enlightening you to the whole process. And so these were all mobile homes, correct?
Yes, yes, mobile manufactured homes.
And what were you all doing exactly with the mobile homes? You were selling them owner finance, or were you financing them, or what was the structure?
No, there are a few lenders that specifically lend for mobile home transactions. A lot of people don't know them, but there are a few lenders. Actually, it's funny that you mentioned that, because one of the key components that really struck a chord in me is, why would one of the richest men in the world, Warren Buffett, and a tremendously valuable investor, invest in mobile homes?
I think he's the largest owner of mobile homes in the world.
Well, I don't know if he's an owner, because as far as I know, he's a lender. He might be an owner as
well. From the lending side.
Correct, yeah, from the lending perspective. And I didn't know why. And I still don't necessarily know the full range of why, but that was the first key that I'm like, wait a minute, if one of the richest, smartest investors in the world is investing in mobile homes, manufactured housing, there's got to be something to it.
You're like, I'm in the right spot. I'm not 100% certain how it fits in, but I know I'm in the good spot here.
Yes, yes. That really intrigued me. So that was one of the, kind of key components. The other thing is, I could see the profit. And, without necessarily disclosing the numbers, there is a tremendous amount of profit in mobile and manufactured homes. And so those were the kind of the key things that really, really struck to me. Now, as time progressed, I met a gentleman that I am, eternally grateful for. His name is Ben Sanchez. He lives in New Braunfels. He's primarily a wholesaler. And I had never heard of the term wholesaling in my life before. But we met
How much time had passed at this point? How long were you at Palm Harbor?
About a year and a half.
Year and a half. So a little while. You had already seen all these different transactions. You already were getting a good grasp of the whole process. At this point, you're a GM, you mentioned. So at this point, you met this other gentleman, and he introduced you to the concept of
wholesaling.
Okay.
Now, that was a really interesting concept, because up until that moment, I assumed that if you were involved in real estate, you somehow had to own the property. You had to own the home, own the land, own the mobile home, build it.
Sure.
I mean, that to me. Now, for those of you who may not necessarily know what wholesaling is about, it's basically a simple transaction where you put under contract your intention to purchase a property, and then you sell that right to someone else. So you never own the property. And you can profit from it.
Substantially.
Substantially. Yeah, substantially. And I met him, literally, we met at a bar and we hit it off. And he showed me what he did. I asked him what he did. I told him what I did. And when I found out that he's able to make...
Was this a random meeting?
Yes.
Or did he pursue you?
Okay. No. It was totally random.
So you were just talking one day and he was like,
yes.
Oh, I am in real estate. And you're like, I'm in real estate. And then it kind of went from there.
Yes, yes. And he's, a man who asks a lot of questions. And when he found out that I was in mobile and manufactured homes, he asked about that. He wasn't too informed about it. And then when I asked him what he was, I thought that he owned a bunch of homes and rented them.
Sure.
That's what I thought. And then when he told me what he did as a primary source of income, it was, again, very enlightening. It was a key component that I thought, there's something here that I need to explore. Now, maybe it was alcohol related, I don't know. But I told him, listen, Ben, I like what you're doing. How do I get involved? And he says, well, a lot of people, they can't do what I do. Not because it's hard, but it does require effort, and it does require time, and you got to pursue,
yep.
The deal, persistence.
Yep.
I said, I don't care. What do I need to do to get involved? And I remember that he said, you know what, I want you to come to my office tomorrow morning and I want you to pick up 100 bandit signs and I want you to go put them out. And I want you to put on the signs, I buy houses and your phone number. Oh. And I said, well, when they call me, what do I say? And he's like, they might not call you. 100 is not enough, but I need for you to do that.
Sure.
And I said, okay, sure. So I've always been a big fan of not necessarily questioning the process. If the process is working for someone and if you trust them, just follow the process and trust the process and have faith in the process.
So let me ask you this. So it sounds like you took immediate action.
Yes.
Because you met him and he was basically the next day.
Yes.
Let's get started. For you, what was it that was so intriguing about the wholesale component that you were like, hey, I want to go all into this. I'm willing the next day to clear out my plans and execute on this.
A couple of things. One, the financial freedom that I could see in him. Now, he's not a multi-million dollar wealthy individual, but I could see in his conversation and when he told me what his week looked like, that he was able to spend it with his wife and his kids. And I was shocked to learn that he didn't clock in, he didn't clock out, he didn't have an office, he did this from his home. Sure. All of that really intrigued me.
And at this time, were you kind of like an 8-to-5 type?
No. I was a 7-to-9
kind
of guy. No.
But you still had to get there at a particular time.
Yes.
And wait till it's all done. So that was probably overwhelming at the time.
Oh, without a doubt.
Sure.
Working at Palm Harbor, I was very blessed because of the income that I was bringing in. But I was working 80 hours a week. I was clocking in at 6-7 o'clock in the morning. And I was leaving at 8-9 o'clock at night,
right,
6 days a week. And I knew, again, very similar to the restaurant situation, that that's not the life that I wanted to live. I knew that. So the restaurant gave me a taste of the life because there was a lot of freedom. If I wanted a day off, I had someone cover it for me.
Sure.
If I wanted to increase my income, I picked up a shift.
Sure.
Palm Harbor gave me the taste of the money.
Sure.
That allowed me to have the life that I wanted, but it did not give me the freedom.
The time.
The time.
Right.
And I thought to myself, okay, we're learning, but it's not quite there.
I really want to highlight what you're saying because I think it's a beautiful point that you just found naturally. But I think a lot of people, they get so fixated on the money. Okay, how can I go do a wholesale deal or do a flip to get the money, and they forget about the time component. And the reality is, if you have the envision of what do you want your life to look like from an all-encompassing standpoint, which includes, okay, yes, I'm making X dollars, but at the same time, I have X amount of free time, and those are in combination giving me the day in, day out kind of life that I'm looking for, then that's truly when you're really finding the happiness that you're looking for. And a lot of people just focus on, all right, they just focus on the money to where I'm trying to get as much money as I can. And typically you're trading your time for that. And the beautiful thing with what you're saying is like, hey, I'm looking for the balance of the two, where I have the money and I can live the lifestyle I want. Everything is great and I can travel and those type of things. But at the same time, you have the time component to spend time with your loved ones, take time for yourself, and really enjoy your life from a holistic standpoint.
Yes.
So, okay, yes. So you found this gentleman. He taught you a little bit about wholesaling.
Correct.
You got started right away.
Next day.
The signs is a lot of signs.
Yeah.
So what happened from there?
Well, I went ahead and I didn't pick him up at his office because Palm Harbor had, we use bandit signs regularly. So I went ahead and did 100 bandit signs. I wrote them, I buy houses. I put my phone number. I took a picture of it. I sent it to him and I said, I'm going to put them out tomorrow. And I did. And 2 days later, I called him back and I said, the signs are out. Now what? like, is the money flowing in or what do I do next? And he didn't believe me. He says, you put 100 bandit signs out? I said, yeah. And he says, give me 3 addresses. And I'm like, are you going to verify? And he's like, yeah. I'm like, you know what? I'll take you everywhere.
Yeah.
Picked him up on his car, and we started driving. And I said, you see that one? That's mine. You see that one? That's mine. Drove 2 miles. You see that one? That's mine. And I think I showed him maybe 10. And he says, all right, I get it. You did it.
You were serious.
Yeah. And he said, and I said, now what? You know, is my phone going to start ringing off the hook? And
right.
He says, well, maybe, but maybe not.
Right.
He says, I've never actually met anybody who I ask him to do this, and this is a big part of the business,
right?
And go out and do it. And now I know you're a serious person.
That's true. That is so very true, and that's amazing that you did it like immediately.
Yeah.
You did it the day after.
Yeah.
There are a lot of people out there that are like, yeah, I want it. Yeah, tell me all the secrets, help me out. And then you're like, all right, here's what to do. And by the way, it's a lot of hard work. And then they're like, well, hard work. Oh, I don't know if I can do it. But yeah. It sounds like you were willing to do whatever it takes.
Yes. And that's, you hit it on the nail. Now in the business that I'm in, as a full-time real estate investor, I do encounter a lot of people, and they say, I want to do what you're doing. I want to enjoy the freedom you're doing. I want to have the income you're having. How can I do it? And it's funny because I've done the same thing that Ben did to me. And I said, well, come to my house.
It's kind of a test in a
way. Yeah. Here's 100 band of signs, and when you put them out, we'll talk. And I would venture to say that 90% of the people, I never even get a call back. And that just crushes me, because if you're not willing to take that step, you're just not the person to receive the amount of blessings
right.
that this can give you.
And the other thing too is it's not necessarily easy to find an individual who has done it, who has done deals, has the experience, has had failures and learned from it, and find that individual who's willing to put time and effort into you. So, you know, the person that is looking for that help should respect that and be willing to do whatever it takes to take advantage of it. And there are a lot of people, unfortunately, that don't take advantage of it.
Yeah.
And it's awesome that you did in that scenario. And I'm sure you've run across a lot of people that don't, but there's those few individuals that do. And those are the ones that are really going to make it.
Yeah. So that was a very, very big blessing. I consider him still one of my most valued mentors. He focuses primarily on wholesaling. I don't wholesale as much, but when it comes to wholesaling, he knows the industry and he knows the business and he knows how to do it. Very, very good.
That was your window, basically.
Yes.
So you put out the signs. Did you end up doing any wholesale transactions?
Not one. Ask me how many times people called me.
How many times?
Three times. Ask me who called me.
Who called?
The city of New Braunfels. To take down my signs.
That's a pretty good percentage ratio.
And I called Ben and I said, dude, I don't have a deal. Like, what happened?
Yeah.
And then he says, you know what? He says, let me show you my numbers. He says, I do an average of 500 bandit signs per week. And I do an average of X amount of Facebook posts. And I do X amount of mailers. And I do this and this and this and this and this. And I spend thousands of dollars per month, and I get about, you know, 2 to 5 deals per month.
Right.
So don't feel bad that out of 100 bandit signs, you haven't gotten any deals. And he said something that really impacted me. He says, the universe will give you when you have become the person that needs to become to receive that blessing. He says, don't take this the wrong way. I think you're on the right step. But it's quite possible that you're just not the person that is ready to receive these blessings. And that's when he educated me into self-development.
That's huge. What you just said is huge. Because a lot of people have the mentality of, what can I do? What actions or tasks can I take to get this result?
How many bandit signs?
Right, which is true to an extent, but the grander question is, who is the person I need to become to get that result?
Yes.
And a lot of people miss that subtle difference, but it's actually a huge difference. And once you become the person, if you want to make 6 figures, you have to become the person that makes 6 figures, which includes self-development, which includes hard work, which includes, positive attitude and all those different things. So that's awesome, man. This gentleman, Ben, sounds like he was a good mentor.
Very good. He's still one of my, my most valued mentors. He introduced me to concepts like self-development, self-education, self-betterment. He introduced me to Rich Dad, Poor Dad. He introduced me to, Think and Grow Rich, Napoleon Hill, reading every day, self-educating yourself, living a more balanced life. Up until that moment, I was kind of coasting.
Sure.
And I don't think I necessarily found the need to change, because I never found myself in danger. Sure. You know, it's not like I was ever homeless. I was ever bankrupt. I was ever in a really bad situation. So it's not like I was getting necessarily bad results. I just wasn't getting necessarily the results that I was looking for. And he introduced me to self-development and self-education and things of that nature.
So Dan, at that point, he introduced you to self-development. Mm-hmm. What were some of the things that you were doing to self-improve? You talked about some books. Were there any books that really stood out to you that you really enjoyed? Or?
Yeah, I Think and Grow Rich obviously is very impactful. I can't imagine a successful entrepreneur that has not read it several times. I try to read it still at least once a year.
By Napoleon Hill.
Yes, Napoleon Hill, absolutely. Then there's a few other books like The Richest Man in Babylon, Robert Kiyosaki's Rich Dad, Poor Dad. Rich Dad, Poor Dad introduced me to, you know, the cash flow quadrant, which really kind of put a visual into where I was. You know, you could either be an employee, you could be self-employed, you could be a business owner, you could be an investor.
Right.
And that book was really impactful in bringing a visual as to, well, this is what it visually looks like. This is where you're at, and this is where you want to be. So that was really, really impactful in my case, and that allowed me to really take things to the next level. I continued employed at Palm Harbor for about 6 months, and I had an aha moment. I think all of us have that one moment.
Your epiphany.
Yes, yes, so to speak. Now, mind you, I didn't do any wholesale deals in these 6 months.
Okay.
I was still putting bandit signs out regularly. I wasn't getting any calls. But I am a firm believer in the process.
You were also doing this kind of part-time.
Yes, yes.
And you were working 80 yes. hours a week, so you weren't able to give it the full
yes.
effort. No, that makes sense.
Yeah.
Okay.
But a situation occurred. I had requested vacation time a week. And on my second day, my manager, my regional manager, calls me up and he says, hey, one of the stores, neighboring stores, their general manager just quit, so I need for you to open it. And I said, well, I probably forgot, I'm on vacation. And he says,
ecstatic, I can't hear you.
And what really was a big eye opener is that he says, I don't care. You're a manager, you need to open up the store tomorrow morning.
Wow.
And click. And I remember that at that moment I made a decision. And I said, no, damn it, this is my time.
Right.
You know, I planned it, I talked about it, I scheduled it, I prepared for it.
Sure.
And I didn't answer the phone, and I didn't go back. And I fully expected to not have a job. Now, the reason I say it was a big eye-opener is because when I came back, not only did I have a job, but I didn't even get a phone call from him. We had a district meeting about 4 weeks later, and I received accolades because my store did so well. And I thought to myself, he really didn't care whether I came back and broke my vacation or not. I don't mean anything to him.
Right.
And I don't mean that as a person.
Right.
I mean just as the corporate setting,
from the business
I had no value.
Right.
Whether I came back or whether I stayed, whether I clocked in or I clocked out.
You were a placeholder.
I was nothing but a placeholder. And at that moment I said, I can't do this, and I quit. I had a substantial amount of savings that could push me through, and then I called Ben again.
Yeah.
And I said, I want to do this full time, but at that point I had been doing a bit of reading, and I said, I don't want to do wholesaling. And the reason I was not attracted to wholesaling is because, in a nutshell, yes, it was very lucrative, but it was also transactional income to me. And if I wanted money, I had to do XYZ. And I would have to continue doing XYZ in order to get.
It was another job, in a sense.
Correct, correct. A job that I controlled, a slightly more lucrative job, a job that gave me more freedom, but still a job.
So it's S in the quadrant, and you wanted to be in the B and I side.
Yes. Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
Now, mind you, I haven't done a deal in all this time.
That's true.
You know, I haven't done a deal. And I started educating myself a little bit as to other avenues of real estate investing, including owner financing and lease options and a few other things. And I kind of put my own self to the test because I owned a little bit of land. And it's funny because my first successful deal, and this is going to go out to every you know, every first time real estate investor, every guru out there will tell you, and correct me if I'm wrong, that you need to go after, in San Antonio, you need to go after $125,000 to $225,000. You need to go from Fortin to 1604, from Bandera to 35.
Right.
And that's where you need to stay at. Well, my first deal, check it out, it was in Elmendorf.
So you really broke that model.
Oh, without a doubt. It was a mobile home.
Oh, okay.
It was 10 acres. It was bought off the MLS. And I paid almost full price, about 95% of fair market value.
Okay, so you're gonna have to break this down. So just like you said, you had, everyone has a little target and with a bullseye over here, and you are way over here.
Way over here.
Okay, well tell me about this deal.
Yes.
Okay.
I found it on the MLS. Now, don't get me wrong, there are not a lot of deals on the MLS, but the reason I love sharing the story is because what we do, Marco, as investors, is we really are problem solvers.
Right.
And that's what I've learned.
Solution seekers.
Solution seekers, yes. We solve real estate problems. And I love sharing this story because it breaks every single mold. It was a mobile home, it was 10 acres, it was in Elmendorf, which there's no reason anybody should invest in Elmendorf. It was bought off the MLS, I paid full retail, pretty much full retail. You know, it breaks every mold.
Yeah.
Now, I love sharing the story of how it happened. It was my personal residence.
Okay.
I lived on 10 acres, and I bought it off the MLS, okay. And I bought it for my personal home. And I bought a mobile home because I was involved in the industry. They're actually built very well. You know, it was a built nice double-wide mobile home, 1,500 square feet.
Plus, you knew what to look for.
I knew what to look for.
Since you were involved with a lot.
So, I thought to myself, how can I, if I'm going to prove myself as an investor, I need to flip this deal. So what do I need to do?
When you purchased it, you said it's for your personal
yes.
residence, but you had the intention from the beginning
to no.
make an investment?
No. Okay.
So how did that transition?
Well, I kind of put myself to this test and I said, if I can find a way to flip this, which was not purchased with all the parameters of a traditional investment, which showed all of the, this can't be flipped, then that will be, to me, proven evidence that you can turn any deal into a deal. That's what that proved to me. I can turn any deal into a deal. Nothing about my home, my residence, the way it was purchased, what it was, in a textbook could be turned into a deal.
I imagine this was a huge confidence booster too after you did it.
Yes. Especially when, you know, when I share with you the results. What did I do? I knew a couple of things about that. And one of the things that I knew is that it would appeal to somebody who wanted to retire in Texas in a ranchette.
And you knew that because of the Palm Harbor
yes.
experience too, because a lot of the people you were selling to were this type of demographic. Type
yes.
Of
okay, yes.
great. How did you go about marketing this deal?
Well, I knew that a 10-acre parcel in Texas, in San Antonio, would be attractive to people up north, Michigan, Iowa, Idaho, Kentucky, who wanted to retire in a Texas ranch.
Sure.
And that's really my pitch. I went ahead and posted on Craigslist in northern states, come retire in a Texas ranchette. I don't know if that's a real word, but that's the word I used. And
that might
be
your term now.
Yeah, Texas that. Ranchette. So I did that, you know, and I included the animals that we had with it.
Okay.
I sold the whole experience. Now I went ahead and purchased it on paper for $165,000, about 95% of ARV, of full market value. No repairs, it was move-in ready. I did a couple of improvements to the property. I went ahead and did a caliche road leading up to the property and I finished up the fence. So I guess if you call that rehabbing, maybe. But basically, that was the marketing. And
you decided to do those repairs because you knew that was what was needed to finish it out.
Correct. Well, not only that, but I knew that ultimately the person who would fall in love with it would be somebody who probably did not necessarily know how or wish to do those things.
Sure.
You know, again, I was selling the retirement in a Texas ranchette
situation.
All inclusive. Yes. Finished product. Yes.
Okay.
So it took me almost 9 months. to sell that deal. But I knew a couple of things. One, I knew that I could garnish more money, marketing it to a group of people who maybe were not being marketed to. And I knew I could also garnish more money by doing an owner finance transaction. So I didn't know a whole lot of the rules. That's the beautiful thing. So that's what I tell investors all the time. Don't bother yourself about wanting to learn all the rules first. Just go out and do it. And I simply started at $300,000. That's what I advertised it for. I had no idea if anybody would buy it, but to me it was kind of a test. If I can flip this, I can make it happen.
And you were advertising in places like Craigslist?
Craigslist. Okay. Only Craigslist.
Okay.
Yes.
Excellent.
Yeah. But in northern states.
Okay, definitely.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it took me about 9 months. And I finally found a lady. She was from North Carolina and she was retired. She was one of those people, I guess, who just wanted a very private life. She did not want her name on it. So what I did for her, again, we are problem solvers, solution seekers, is we opened up a land trust.
Okay.
So her name would not be on
sure.
it. And we owner financed the transaction.
Nice.
$100,000 down.
Talk about a down payment.
Yes, talk about a down payment. Now this is the beauty of it. There was still a mortgage on it.
Okay.
So what I did is I went ahead and did a wrap mortgage to it.
Okay. So since you have not done a transaction like that before, what did you just reach out to like a real estate attorney or did Ben help you? How did
That's
you get
Ben helped me,
it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Ben knew, although he primarily wholesales, he knows owner finance, he knows wrap mortgages. He knows, you know, RMLOs. He knows a lot of those things. So yeah, he was a
so
big.
So you use the power of your network.
Yes.
And your mentor to be like, hey, I've never done this before. In concept, I know it can be done. How do I do it?
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
So he's the one who connected me with a few people. He connected me with Victor Moss, which is a local real estate attorney. He says he can do his closing with him. I didn't know what a wrapped mortgage was.
Sure.
I figured, you know, it was real funny because I figured, well, I have a mortgage. I guess if she pays more, well, I can take that money and pay my mortgage to make a little bit of money every month.
Yeah.
I didn't know that was called a wrapped mortgage. I did it.
You're like, this is mathematically.
Yeah, you know. And I should get paid more because she's not having to go get a loan. That made sense to me.
Right.
And she didn't want to get a loan because she didn't want anything under her name.
So this was truly all-inclusive. Not only was the land and the house and everything was taken care of, but you even did the financing
Correct.
For her too.
And she did ask me, I think she talked to a couple of real estate agents, and I think those wonderful real estate agents kind of hinted that $185,000, which was the final negotiated price, I'm sorry, $285,000, which was the final negotiated price, was a little more than the home was worth. And she did ask me. She says, you know what, I've talked to a few people, and they kind of told me that it's a little bit more than what it's worth. And I remember I looked her in the eye and I said, I know. I don't understand what the issue is. And she says, you can decide not to buy it. You know, this is America. This is a free market. If I wish to put it on the market for $1 million and somebody wishes to pay me $1 million, well, then that's what it's worth to them. But I'll tell you why you're going to buy it. You're going to buy it because I'm not just selling the land and I'm not just selling the home and I'm not just selling the property. I'm selling you the fact that you want to stay private for the rest of your life. You want to be, you don't want your name anywhere on the property or on the financing. And that is worth about $100,000. And she says, well, I don't know about that. And I said, you know what? You're right. It's your money. You tell me if it's worth it. And I thought she was backing out. And she called me about 2 weeks later and she says, you know what? You're right. I've been looking for 2 years for somebody to help me the way you're helping me.
And she was like, I always wanted a ranchette.
Well, actually, she did want land. She was originally looking for about 4 or 5 acres, but she was happy with 10. You know, how much is that privacy worth to you? And how much is it? Well, I don't know. Maybe it's only worth 20. Maybe it's worth $1 million. I don't know. But I'm selling it to you at about $100,000, and it's your choice whether you want to buy it at $100,000.
I think that's an amazing point because the conversation that you had with the lady there to basically make the deal a successful one was not about numbers. You mm-hmm. removed the numbers from the conversation. Instead, back to what you said earlier, you found out what her problem was or what her goal was, mm-hmm. and you said, I am providing that.
Correct.
I'm giving you what you want. And in fact, I'm doing a little bit extra. It's more land than you were anticipating. I'm doing the financing for you, completely private, all these different things. And this is just the price to give you the package with a bow on it for what you want.
Exactly.
And it worked out.
And it worked out really well. When we finally closed, it was basically a deal that netted me about $80,000 in profit. And it's also a deal that generated me about $425 in a spread, a monthly spread for the next 30 years.
So let me ask you this. How did you come up with your number?
What number? What,
the number to sell it. Because you bought it at $165.
Out of my butt.
Just came up?
Yes. Okay. In my mind, I thought, if I can flip it for double, I bought it for $165, so $300 was kind of a round double number. That's going to be the litmus test for me. That A, there is money here.
Right.
B, I can do it. And three, this is where I want to be. That was kind of the litmus test for me. And it took me 9 months to produce it.
Right.
And sure, it wasn't $300,000. We ended up negotiating at $285,000. But for your first deal to be a mobile home on land in Elmendorf, Texas, bought off the MLS, having no rehabbing, really, for the most part, and generating an $80,000 profit with a $400 monthly spread, I mean, that's a home run.
That's
How big of a home run that was back then. I know now. That's a huge home run.
So during that 9 month time frame, were there any doubts that you would be able to do this deal? Were there any reservations? Did you, you know, did you always have the confidence that it was going to get done? What was your mental state since this was your first deal?
Yeah. Obviously, there were, you know, roller coasters up and down. I did believe that it was going to get done. I didn't know when, and I didn't know how.
Was that just because you had confidence in yourself?
Well, I was a little bit confidence in myself, but I've always been a believer. There's a saying in Spanish that says, siempre hay un roto para un descosido, which basically translated means you can always find your pair. You can always find that other piece that matches you. I did believe that I had something of value, and I did believe that there was one person out there among the 8 billion people that it would be a good fit. I just didn't know how long it was gonna take me to find that one person.
Sure.
So it wasn't necessarily confidence in me or my ability. It was just more confidence in, you know, mathematics or statistics or probability. There had to be some person out there.
Sure.
I didn't know where they lived. I didn't know who their names were. And I didn't know how long it was going to take me to get it. So it did take me 9 months. Now, for all the viewers out there who are thinking, you know, why did I stick with it? Why didn't I really make changes? I was doing the marketing part-time basis. I was not a full-time investor. This was a litmus test for me.
Sure.
And obviously I didn't know how to market it. I didn't really have gurus out there who would tell me how to market a 10-acre parcel in Elmendorf with a mobile home bought off the MLS.
Right.
There's not a lot of people who can tell you that.
Sure.
So it took me time. So that was kind of the issue. But no, I was confident that I would find the person. I just didn't know when.
That's awesome. So always have, I think that's a common trait with successful people, is they always had the belief that it'll get done, the belief that they'll figure it out, the belief that even if there's setbacks or failures, that, you know, they would be able to adjust and ultimately get to the end result that they're looking for. And that's where that perseverance really comes in.
Yes.
So it sounds like this deal was pretty much great all the way through, but were there any mistakes along the way that you made with it, or any areas that you would have improved or you learned from that first deal?
Yeah, there were definitely challenges lessons that I learned from it. I think I spent a lot of time with people who were never qualified in the first place to even purchase. Okay. I think that there might have been people who might have been qualified to purchase and desiring to purchase, but maybe I did not have a system in place to follow up with them. That's still a challenge that I'm looking at right now, systems to allow me to properly follow up with people.
Sure.
But overall, I can honestly say that it took time, it took patience, it took belief. That's a huge thing. If you're starting out, you have to believe in the system, you have to believe in the process. this will work.
And believe in yourself.
And you have to believe in yourself, yeah. Yeah, you do have to believe in yourself.
Awesome. So you did that deal. I'm sure you were like, all right, I can do this. Now I need to take on the world because I have this confidence that I got it done, my first deal. What did you do from there?
I thought rinse and repeat. You know, that's really what I did. I took most of my earnings and reinvested it into another deal. I knew that I wanted to take some of my earnings and invest it in marketing, some of it invested in education, but the bulk of it was to be reinvested back in another deal. And I kind of fell back on what I felt comfortable, which was mobile manufactured home. I had still very good relations with Palm Harbor company and managers, and I went ahead and looked for another mobile home. The numbers of that story, it's real simple. It was a double-wide manufactured home. It's about 15 years old. I went ahead and bought it for $6,000. It cost me almost $4,000 to move and set up in a local mobile home park, and I went ahead and owner financed it.
This was your second deal?
This was the second deal, yes.
All right. So you went from 165 down to 6 grand.
Yes.
Talk about negotiating skills that you improved. No, I'm joking.
Well, it wasn't even, you know, negotiating skills per se. It was a trade-in.
Sure.
And, you know, Palm Harbor and all of other companies, they don't always buy it if it's not up to quality.
Sure.
But the new buyer of the new mobile home they're selling them to, they had to sell the old one.
Sure.
So they basically sent me a, you know, called me up and say, hey, we have this deal, this person, you know, we've already negotiated him down to $6,000. There's a lot of money in mobile homes. I didn't necessarily buy it cheap.
Sure.
That's really what it was worth. I mean, that's kind of the truth.
Sure.
Now, it's a perfectly habitable. I did spend about $5,000, you know, new carpet, new flooring.
It.
Yeah. But those are the numbers that you work on mobile and manufactured homes. A big chunk of it was moving it and setting it up in a new land. I wanted to find a small parcel of land, maybe an acre or so, to put it on. I wasn't able to. Time kind of flew. I had to move in about 2 weeks' worth, so I put it in a mobile home park, and I went ahead and owner financed it.
I love that since you were starting, you really leveraged your past experience and your past knowledge. And not only that, it sounds like you leveraged your past contacts as well,
yes.
your network, to be able to find this deal and put this deal together to be able to continue the ball rolling in your investment portfolio, which is awesome.
Yes.
So you owner financed that one. So that's two owner finances.
Correct. My first two deals, both owner financed.
And then where did you go from there?
From that point forward, I really liked the concept of owner financing because of the passive income. You have to do a transaction only once and you get paid for the next 10, 15, 20, 30 years. And even if it's not a lot of money, that component made a lot of sense to me.
It's kind of the best of both worlds. You get that down payment up front, you get the monthly income for a substantial amount of time, and then you minimize the whole headache that can happen along the way, which is maintenance, which is taxes, insurance, all that gets handled for you.
Yes.
So it's kind of a set it and forget about it.
Set it and forget
as much
about
as you can
it.
In a sense.
Yeah.
To make it happen. All right, excellent. So you fell in love with that strategy. That was your go-to. As you're going through these and you're looking for your deals, what are some of the lessons that you're learning along the way? How are you improving your systems? What were some of the different processes that you were going through to continue to do more and more?
I think one of the biggest things that I learned is just rinse and repeat. This is not brain surgery, what we do. This is meat and potatoes. These are basics.
Right.
Someone has a home that doesn't want or doesn't need or can't handle or maybe losing to foreclosure, and somebody needs a home and they have a good down payment and they have a good job history, and you put the two together.
Right.
Not as an agent. I'm not representing the party. I'm actually purchasing on one end, providing value, improving the situation, and presenting it to the other end. So one of the things that I've learned is I'm naturally kind of creative and inventive, and I've learned that everything that I need in order to be successful has probably already been done. As a matter of fact, it has been done by somebody successfully.
Right.
So go out and seek those people. Go out and read their books, read their stories, get in touch with them. They've already done it. Learn from them. Success leaves clues. Follow those clues, follow those patterns, and hopefully, you know, avoid some of the mistakes that you could be doing. Don't try to reinvent the wheel. The wheel's pretty darn good. It works, it rolls, it moves, you can't fix it. Just You know, go and use the wheel. That's kind of the biggest things that I've learned.
So I think that's a powerful point, because the ability to go seek out mentors, other people that are in the industry, and it doesn't even have to be a live person, it can be through a book, it could be through audio course, it could be other avenues in which people have already been doing what you're trying to achieve. And the power in that is those people have already made a lot of mistakes, have already gone through some failures, and they've shifted and adjusted and evolved into a sense to where they're not making the same mistakes. They're able to do the rinse and repeat that you're talking about on a consistent and successful level. And by leveraging that, you can avoid some of those mistakes yourself, which will actually accelerate your progress. So I think that's a beautiful point to make, that a lot of people should really try and go after is leverage other people's experiences.
Yes. And you know, what's interesting is you don't have to go out and spend $50,000 on a mentor or a guru, or I haven't. I don't know if you have, but I've met a lot of people who haven't, and they're very successful at what they do. Books, audios, those truly wonderful mentors, they've already put their thoughts into writing. Go to Amazon and spend $12, $15, $18. Or if you're cheap, go to a secondhand store and spend $4 or $5. Yeah. The same information.
Or go to the library.
You could check it out. So that's something very, very big for me.
Excellent. So that basically got the ball rolling, and then you started doing deal after deal after deal.
Correct.
What are you working on now? What is your focus now? What are you doing today, Dan?
Well, I'm still focusing on owner finance transactions. Okay. Now, in order for you to do owner finance transactions, there are two types of deals. This might sound silly, but you have to own the property.
Sure.
And I know that seems obvious, but it's a challenge, because I don't have $1 million.
Sure.
To go ahead and buy $1 million worth of real estate. So how am I owner financing a lot of the properties? There's two ways. One is the marketing. We actively look to help people who are facing foreclosure avoid a foreclosure by buying the property subject to the existing financing. Now, one of the challenges in that situation is that they're generally behind on payments, so you gotta catch up the loan.
Right.
Which could easily be $10,000, $15,000, $20,000. You probably also have to rehab the home a little bit to some degree. So that could be $5,000, $10,000, $15,000.
Sure.
And there's not a lot of lenders in the traditional institutions that are necessarily willing to lend under those circumstances. They're not going to get a first lien property. There's already an underlying mortgage. There's a lot of situations involved. So that's where I have found, ironically, a third group of people that we're able to help. We're able to help sellers, we're able to help buyers, but now we're also able to help private individuals that have normal jobs, that have healthy retirement accounts, that are maybe unsatisfied with the fluctuation of their 401ks.
Probably.
Trying to be, it's probably a little rough for them. But, maybe we're approaching retirement age and they don't want to see that fluctuation anymore. And I've learned a totally different avenue that, America's a beautiful country. If you have money and it's doing nothing in your bank account, or you have a 401k, or you have some sort of retirement account, you can actually take that money and invest it in real estate, either through purchasing or through funding deals. So for example, I have recently learned that if I have a piece of property, let's say it's $100,000 to fund, to buy, I can go ahead and owner finance it for $150,000. Well, I need $100,000.
Right.
I might not have $100,000. And even if I had $100,000, well, I ran out of my money.
Sure.
So there's only so many deals we can do. Well, I can help a third person by allowing them to come in and say, hey, listen, how much have you made on your 401k? 4%, 5%, 6%?
If they've made anything.
On the good years? Let's talk about what you've lost. How would you like to lend to fund this transaction? Let me tell you about that transaction. The transaction is worth $150,000. You're only putting up $100,000. The end buyer is going to be putting a 20% down payment. You're going to be getting a fixed rate of return of 8, 9, 10%. Does that make sense to you? And usually it does, because most investments that people have access to right now, 401ks, it's a stock market, CDs, you know, at 2%. So most Americans don't have access to the really nice wealth building 7%, 8%, 9%, 10%, consistent.
And it's not mainstream.
It is not mainstream. And it's collateralized with real estate.
Yep.
You can go to 123 Main Street and say, I own that house. I've got the note to that house.
Right.
Which is kind of important as well. It's a very stabilizing factor.
You know, that's an excellent point, and that really goes back to what you were saying earlier, which is, yes, you're in the realm of real estate. You are a real estate investor, but real estate is only the vehicle in which you're solving problems and helping people. And not only are you helping, like you mentioned, the buyer, and you're helping the seller, but helping this third party who either doesn't have the time, doesn't have the energy, or doesn't have the knowledge.
Or some desire.
Or desire, yeah, that's true. Maybe they just want to be in the beach over there collecting a check every single month. You know, they don't have the want, the ability to do a deal like that. So that's where you're over here raising your hand saying, hey, let's work together. Let's work together to not only do a deal to where you make money, but we're actually improving the community, we're helping individuals, we're doing a good thing for the people around us. And they're happy because they're getting a consistent check every single month that is a high interest rate when you compare it to any normal investment out there that is secured by a real asset. And typically they have such a big spread on what the value of the property is compared to what they've loaned on it, so a great loan to value threshold, and they can be in a very good spot. And this is something that if the owner that you owner finance it to, if they ever refinance or they ever sell the property and they get all their money back, well, you can put their money back to work on the next deal. And at that point you've increased it, maybe they can do two deals and it's a snowball effect. So I think that's a beautiful thing. And there's a lot of people that just are unaware that's even a possibility or even a reality. And clearly it's something that can be done all the time over and over. Okay. So with private lenders, What is it about private lenders that really, the service that you really provide that really helps them in achieving what they want to achieve?
Well, when it comes to private individuals, most people are thinking towards retirement and they want a return on their investment. And if they've been working at a traditional company, at a traditional job for the last 20, 30 years, they probably have $300,000, $400,000, $500,000 in their retirement accounts. And it's a little unsettling that you have no direct ability to say, I want to do this with that money. So that's one of the biggest things that we do. We're able to take that money and say, what do you want to do with it? Do you want to buy rental properties? I'll get you great rental properties. Do you want to fund great deals with a constant 8, 9, 10% return on your investment that's secured by real estate should anything go wrong? You will be first lien position on that note. Does that kind of attract you? And once you start doing the math, the beautiful thing about wealth building is that you need time, but you also need a consistent return on investment. And most people, unfortunately, they don't have that access to a consistent return on investment. If all you're investing is in the stock market, you can lose it all. And then what? In real estate, there's something that you can touch, you can hold. It does not have the up and down volatility of the stock market. It's gonna be an asset that people will always need and people will always have. And contrary to popular belief, it is fairly liquid. You're holding a note. So if tomorrow you need to cash out, there's people who will buy those notes.
Right.
So it does have a certain amount of liquidity to it. And that's really one of the biggest things that I found very rewarding, is that we can help buyers, we can help sellers, we can help the community by improving the community and putting good families in those homes. And now we can help a totally other segment of people that are anxious to learn about how I can make my money work more for me. What they have access to right now, which are CDs and the bank, that's gonna be 1% maybe. You know, 401ks, depending on the year you had, you might have had 3 or 4%, or you might have lost money.
Right.
So that volatility is scary, you know, when you're in your 40s and your 50s and you're 10 years away from retirement.
Sure.
You know, it's scary. So that's, it's beautiful and very rewarding to be able to bring those people in as well. And when you're able to bring those people in, then you're able to help even more buyers and even more sellers. Then there's no limit to the amount of people you can help. And that's really what brings me a lot of joy.
Definitely. And you know, it's something that is very impactful, and a lot of people are like, well, this is something, you know, I want to invest in real estate. I would love to be a private lender, but I've never really heard of it before, or it's something that's different, or, you know, I've never really explored that idea. And immediately people go to, you know, what is the worst case scenario? What is something that could go wrong? Well, the thing I love about the way you do your deals is you sell them owner finance, and you're not just putting somebody in there as a renter who could, you know, stop paying and then you have to evict them and maybe they've done damage to the property and, you know, moved out. You're getting actual people that have put a substantial amount down, which that in itself is a security, because, you know, with a renter who moves in and they, you know, decide to get out of there or whatever, what are they losing? Maybe 1 month's worth of deposit, maybe a little bit of rent that they've been paying. Whereas an owner finance buyer, they have a whole completely different mentality. They've put in thousands of dollars down. Like your first deal, $100,000 down. Do you think that lady's gonna stop paying?
Nope.
No, she's gonna be there. She wants to protect that $100,000 that she put into the deal. And they have a completely different mindset. They're not renters, they're owners. This is a house that they own, they're paying taxes on, they have insurance on. And the other thing too is, because they're homeowners, typically in a lot of situations, they're improving the underlying asset. They're putting porches on, they're you know, upgrading the flooring, maybe putting some granite countertops in. They're making your asset better, which is making it even more valuable, so you have an even better collateral there to secure your investment. So I love that you're doing owner finance, and I know that the private lenders that you work with love that idea too, which adds another layer of security.
It does, it does. They're very, very happy with the numbers. They're very happy with the returns. They're very happy with the results. And, you know, they're calling me and they're saying, you know, we have more money. Do you have more deals? You know, so we're constantly looking for deals, and we're constantly looking for additional lenders who are just, you know, looking for a different alternative to it. So that's a great, great component as well of
Definitely.
What we do.
So how can people get a hold of you, Dan? What's the best way in which people can reach you? How can they find out more about what you're doing? And if they're interested in working with you and potentially doing some deals with you, what would be the best manner in which they could get a hold of you?
Well, I'm glad you brought that up. I was born and raised in San Antonio. I'm not going anywhere. If you live in San Antonio, call me up. We'll do coffee. We'll do lunch.
Margaritas.
We'll do margaritas on the Riverwalk. Yeah, we'll do margaritas. You will not be giving money under the influence of alcohol, but, yeah, you know, let's just meet. Let's have a conversation. My cell phone number, I have no problem giving it out to individuals. I've had it for 20 years, 210-421-4447. Call me. Want to send me out by an email address? Shoot me an email, dan.diaz@texascashhomebuyer.com. Let's connect. I'll share with you what I'm doing. I'll share with you past deals that I've done in the past, sharing with you the numbers. I just finished a deal where the investor, it was a very short-term loan. So the annualized ROA was 56%. Can I guarantee that every time? No, it just happened to be a very quick turning deal.
Sure, sure.
But I have no problem sharing with you what I've done in the past and talking to you about what makes sense to you.
Right.
Do you want short-term investments where you can get your money back at maybe a higher interest rate? Are you looking for a situation where you do once and you forget about it for the next 10, 15 years and owner finance transactions at a fixed interest rate? What makes sense to you? Where
right.
are you at in your life?
No, that's definitely awesome, because you kind of customize it around what they're looking for. And I know when you sit down with them, you really go over all the different details, answering all their different questions, because for a lot of people, it's a newer concept. But really, if you don't have the specific knowledge, you have the team the members in place to really help assist. You have the real estate attorneys, you have the agents, you have the title companies that all work together under you for your team to make the deal successful.
Correct.
And you know, it's just a great opportunity for people to find another avenue and really not only put their money to good use for themselves, but also make a positive impact in the community, like we were talking about earlier.
Yes, absolutely. And like I said, I'm local to San Antonio. Call me, send me an email, we'll do lunch. If nothing else, you know, we'll connect on a different level, and hopefully you'll see value in you know, investing with us. That would bring me a lot of happiness, and I know you're going to be very happy. And like you did say, it isn't me. There's a team behind me. I don't have all the answers, but I know where to get them.
Right.
So if you have a specific question about, you know, how does this work, or the legality, or the paperwork, or, you know, what happens, then I'll connect you with the appropriate people who are or knowledgeable, you know, in that area, whether it's real estate attorneys, whether it's title companies, whether it's asset management companies, investment companies, that they can kind of answer your questions. I don't know all the answers, but right. I know where to get them.
The power is not having all the knowledge yourself. The power is having access to the answers and having the right individuals as part of your team, because it's the team mentality. You know, real estate's a team sport.
Yes.
And having the right team really allows you to do more, be more profitable, more fruitful with what you're doing, and do it the right way.
Yes, absolutely. I totally agree with you.
So are there, you know, there's a lot of people that watch this episode that are getting interested in real estate. They want to get into real estate. Are there any final thoughts that you would give those individuals that really want to get into the real estate realm, but for whatever reason they haven't at this point?
Well, there are words that I can share with you, and it really depends on where you're at in life. But bottom line, you have to take massive action. If you're at the point where you want to get into wholesaling, go out and put bandit signs. Go out and buy a list. It doesn't matter if it's a crappy list. It's not the list that's going to get you the deals. It's the habit of mailing out to that list.
The effort.
It's the effort. And you have to also think about yourself. Are you the kind of person who is ready to receive these kind of blessings? I know it can be very humbling. A lot of people think, oh, you know, I want to make a six-figure income. I want to, you know, be bringing in $10,000, $15,000, $20,000 a month residual. Well, that's great, but are you prepared for it? If the universe were to materialize it right now, would you be responsible with it? What does your private life say? You know, are you full of debt? Do you spend right now on luxuries that you probably can't afford? Are you buying liabilities, or are you buying assets? You can have very limited income, and you can still buy assets.
Right.
You know, I met this guy, real nice guy, but he totally has an entrepreneur mindset. What he does is he goes to the flea market every Wednesday, Southside, and he has about $200 with him every time. He's the first person to arrive, and when the vendors are barely bringing out their things, he buys it from them as cheap as he can. What do you think he does with those things?
Probably sells them on eBay or something.
You think?
Yeah.
No, 9 o'clock, he opens up his own stand at that same flea market. And he has little tags that has a number, and that number is what he paid for. And he will sell for any number above that number.
Nice.
And he walks away every single Wednesday with $200 to $400, $500. He's not wealthy. He's struggling. But he's taking action, and he is working on his entrepreneur mindset. So that's what you need to work on. You need to be that person that is the right person, so that the universe can bless you with all of those things. You can't just say I want it because I deserve it, or I need it, or, you know, it doesn't work that way. You got to work on yourself too.
You got to become that individual.
Yeah, and take action. You know, if it's wholesaling bandit signs, if it's you know, if you got a full-time job and you know you want to invest in real estate and you've got, you know, cash and you don't know how, private money lending is the way to go. Take action. Call me. Call someone. Read a book. Educate yourself. So it depends on where you're at and what you want to do. But take action. Take action. Persistence. Work on yourself. Work on your mindset. And you'll get there. You absolutely will get there.
Well, those are some amazing words. And I think they're some words that some people need to hear. And hopefully people become the individuals they need to become and take the action that they need to take. And ultimately, it was a pleasure to sit down and talk,
hear
your
story. Oh, the pleasure is mine. The honor is mine.
Thank you, Dan. And I hope everyone that is interested in private lending and just wants to do deals in general. I know you're a very giving individual, so I hope they reach out to you so they can further their own careers and further their own situations. But make sure to like this episode, go ahead and share it, and look forward for the next episode that's coming here in the future. Thank you.
Sounds good.